Okay, yes, thanks for allowing us to present this work that we have done together with Paolo Cheminelli and Filippo Bernizzi, who is here in the audience. Yes, and this work is about the effective theory of inflation and how we can simplify. So what do we mean by this? Okay, we know that during inflation, the metric is quantum fluctuations, both tensor and scalar. And in standard scenarios, these fluctuations get frozen out when all the modes exit the horizon. And we can use this then to start initial conditions for the late-time evolution of the structure that we observe today in the universe. So this also tells us that we have a freedom to perform any redefinition of these fluctuations that decay at late times, because such redefinitions will not change any correlation function, and then they will not change any physical observable. For example, you can consider the case when we take the moving curvature perturbation zeta and we send it into itself plus its time derivative. Since we know that zeta becomes a constant at late times, this will not change any correlation function that involves it. But this is similar to what happens in quantum field theory in a standard Minkowski background, because then we know that the physical observables, which are the asymmetric elements, are left invariant by Fielder definitions. And we also know that we can try and use these redefinitions to simplify the actions, the action for the fluctuations. That is, we can just try and see if there are some operators that give the same asymmetric elements. And what we're going to do is play basically the same game, just in the context of inflation. More precisely, we work in the effective theory for single crop inflation, where we have only one scalar degree of freedom, the type of expansion. And when we go in unitary gauge, and the perturbations to this degree of freedom are written by the metric, the building blocks that we have at our disposal to construct the Lagrangian are basically all the operators that are invariant under diffs, all diffs, like for example the Fourier scalar. But you can also consider operators that are invariant only under special diffs, because they are constructed directly from the foliation defined by the inflaton. Like for example, we have the Ricci scalar or the extrinsic curvature. So basically, the Lagrangian that we have is given by this equation, where we have the standard Einstein Hilbert term here, and we have the minimal action for a standard scalar field, that is the Mandel-Senna action. And with the dots, we denote all the other operators that we can construct from these building blocks, basically. And in this work, we have focused on operators that go up to cubic order in perturbations. And this allows us to study up to the bispectra of primordial scalar and tensor fluctuations. And we stop at second order in derivatives. So now one can ask, what is the most general definition that one can do? And in principle, this can be very complicated, because we have a lot of tools at our disposal. We can, for example, consider adding to the metric some tensor product of the normal to the surfaces of constant inflaton. And this is a disformal transformation. But we can imagine adding other terms, like, for example, the extrinsic curvature and so on. However, we can also quickly realize that such a general redefinition will bring us out of the assumption of having at most two derivatives in the action. Because we know that there is the Einstein-Hilbert term. And under a redefinition, this will change. And we know also from our GR courses that it's changed given by the Einstein tensor, and this contains already two derivatives in acting on the metric. But this tells us that if we want to preserve the number of derivatives and we want to stop to two derivatives in the action, the redefinition that we can do is kind of limited. We can just do a generalization of a conformal and a disformal transformation. This is the conformal part and this is the disformal part. And we have six free parameters at our disposal. This is F5 parameters, which are free functions of time. And the conformal and disformal factors are constructed from the perturbation to the lapse function, that is this delta n. And Lorenzo will now explain to you what we can do with these redefinitions.
Thank you, Jeremy. And so, okay, here I just want to give you an example of how this procedure works. So, for example, I'm considering as inflationary Lagrangian the Einstein, the minimal action, so Einstein-Hilbert plus the kinetic field, plus the kinetic term for the inflaton, plus these other two operators, which are in principle allowed in the effective theory of inflation. And both of them contribute, for example, to the scalar tensor-tensor action. However, we can consider this field definition, and after we perform it, we see that the action change, the Lagrangian change, the couplings in front of the two operator changes, for example, and they become dependent on the parameters F3 and F4. So we can tune them in such a way to set to zero these two couplings. So The bottom line is that the observables do not depend on these two operators in this function, in this theory. Then what we did is to apply systematically this procedure for all the filter definitions to our disposal. So we identify the minimal set of operators which contributes up to cubic order in perturbation and a second order in derivatives. And the main prediction of this minimal set are that, for example, the tensor modes are fixed by the Einstein Hilbert term. So this means that the tensor power spectrum and the tensor B spectrum are fixed. For example, there is just one shape for the tensor B spectrum. A similar statement can be done also for the scalar tensor-tensor cubic action, in the sense that just the Einstein Hilbert term can contribute to it. However, this does not mean that the three-point function zeta gamma gamma is fixed, just because there is still this scalar sector which is unconstrained. Then we considered a slightly different setup. So always in the context of the effective field theory, we identified, we assumed a derivative expansion. So in this situation, the dominant operators are the one with no derivatives acting on the metric. So this means that the dominant operators are the one that we can construct with the G00 component of the metric. So this is nothing but a P of X Lagrangian, being X the kinetic term of the inflaton. In this situation, we have six additional filter definitions that we can perform that mimic a time dip, so they are of this sort, and they do not change the Einstein Hilbert action, but they act on the operators with zero derivatives, so we can still stay at second order in derivatives. So in this case, what we found is that the small corrections after the filter definition consist just in three higher derivatives operators. Finally, we try to say something on higher order in derivatives. So in this situation, we have a plethora of new operators which arise, so we just focused on tensor modes for simplicity, and we assumed also parity. And we found that at third order in derivatives, there are no operators which could change the tensor power spectrum, but there is one new shape for the tensor B spectrum. This operator leads to a gamma 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 three-point function, which is different. Finally, at fourth order in derivatives, we found that after integration by parts and after filter definitions, there is just one operator which can affect the tensor power spectrum. This operator is due to the coupling with the inflaton, and so to it, it corresponds a zeta gamma gamma three-point function, which could be in principle sizable because it is not slow or suppressed. And in principle, yes, we could also see it. With this, I finish, and I thank you all for the attention.
Thank you.